Bismillah, walhamdulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, Assalaamu Alaikum wa rahmatullah. And welcome to the new idea of this table of content, where I will present the topics or the points that I will discuss in this talk, and I will do this with any subsequent talks, inshallah, that every time I will present a talk, I will put a table of content, a small one, so that you listen to it and see what I will discuss in my talk, and then after that you decide if you want to listen to it or not. Though I always recommend that you listen to my talks, because there is just a lot of knowledge in it. And as I said before, my talks are not pieces of information. No, they are pieces of life-changing knowledge. Take that knowledge, take notes, and do change your life. In this final installment of Al-Israa and Al-Miraaj, this is part 4 of this third installment, where I will discuss a few points. I've already discussed the introduction and then ideas about that. Anyhow, you go back to the last few parts of Al-Israa and Al-Miraaj. The reason it's taking me this long, because this belief is so ingrained in the human psyche, in the Muslim psyche, that they take it for granted. And it is not, it's not an event that even took place. So point number one, I will link the talk with the previous ones that to create some form of cohesion between the different topics of Al-Israa and Al-Mi'raj. Just to link it to the other parts, and I will speak about the circumstances in which the people of Mecca had asked the messenger that Allah sends a miracle to them. And they set a list of miracles that they would accept from the messenger so that they believe in him. And I will speak about why circumstances do not affect Allah's decisions. That's why sometimes the prophets ask Allah for something and Allah doesn't give it to them as much as they would want to. And then I will speak about why Allah did not answer the disbelievers of Mecca, why he didn't give them any of their demands, not even one, and why he didn't give any miracles to the messenger, why he answered them different to what they were asking. Also, we will see, well, we'll discuss the Buraq, that is the two-winged flying horse. Does it exist? Its description, discussion about it, and why this beast exists. Our duty is not to take Islam to humans, but just take the Quran to them and invite them to look into the Quran. This is also a point that plays a big role in this talk. Also, we will see the true reason behind the demands of Quraysh or the people of Mecca. And one of the major points that we will stop and discuss in this talk is, does Jannah and Hellfire exist now? Or at the time of the messenger, did the messenger really enter paradise and hellfire? Are the people who are being punished in hellfire or enjoying in paradise, did the messenger truly see them? The messenger of Allah and the grapes of paradise, the castle and woman of Umar, that he claims that he saw them and that he remembered how Umar was jealous. So did all that happen or not? We're also going to take a look at Ibn Kathir, a statement about Al-Israa and Al-Mi'raj, because he laid it down in his tafsir and his books of history, books of hadith and so on and so forth. And what Ibn Kathir said is what is being preached today. Ibn Kathir came about 8 centuries after the death of the messenger. If Jannah and Hellfire exist now, or at the time of the messenger, where are they? Is hellfire truly shut in Ramadan and Jannah decorated further in Ramadan? Is truly paradise and hellfire, especially hellfire, is it in the center of earth and paradise is up in the heaven? Of course, this is a Christian belief. It's not an Islamic one. And we will discuss this point, inshallah, when we get there. Will Jannah and paradise and hellfire, will they be destroyed when Allah destroys the entire universe, or will they not? Because if we believe that hellfire is in the center of the earth, then it will be destroyed and then recreated again. So have you been tricked and duped about the existence of these two final destinations? What does the Quran say about this? Does Allah say something? Of course he does. But it's just the Quran is being ignored. Why did the Messenger of Allah ask people to tell him about their dreams? We will speak about that. And when none of these people, the companions that prayed with him Fajr, none of them told him about their dreams, he volunteered one of his own dreams. And what the dream that he told them became a religion for us. We will discuss that dream and we will see what happened in it that has become a religion. You'll be surprised. Where do humans go when they die? Can they return back to earth to haunt people? Can they visit us in our lives? Can they be spirits? Also, we're going to learn about the hadith narratives, which says that Allah, now pay attention, Allah visited the messenger in his dream, okay? Then Allah put his hand on the back of the messenger. And this narrative is classified as authentic and even authenticated by Al-Albani is, and this belief that Allah visited the messenger, put his hand on the back of the messenger, and then suddenly Allah transferred the knowledge of everything to the messenger, which means the messenger became equal to Allah. All this is authentic hadith and is part of the belief of the Muslim organized religion. And when I say Muslim organized religion, is any religion that has an institution that is linked to the government or an independent institution. Islam was never to be like that. Islam came to set us free, establish connection with Allah and move on. But anyhow, so we will discuss that as well. The messenger, this is another one, blasphemous hadith that we will discuss as in al-Bukhari, where it says that the messenger of Allah, pay attention and get ready for this one. The messenger of Allah visits, and this is on judgment day, the messenger of Allah will go to visit Allah in his house. So the hadith in al-Bukhari, which is authentic, says that Allah has got a house and the messenger of Allah will go to that house and will ask permission to intercede for people, to speak to Allah, then intercede for people. This exists in al-Bukhari. And this is strange, but anyhow, we'll discuss this blasphemous hadith. Also, we're going to learn about a messenger, and I will not say his name here, but we will discuss this one. A messenger who was heard by our messenger of Allah when he went into this Israa and Miraaj. He heard the other messenger shouting at Allah, rebuking Allah, because this particular messenger disagrees with Allah. This narrative is classified authentic and is even authenticated by Al-Albani and a plethora, a huge number of scholars. You get the point? A human being shouting at Allah, screaming at Allah, disagreeing with Allah. But anyhow, we'll discuss this more in the talk. Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj. We'll discuss this one. This point number 21. The point Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj are gateways to kufr and shirk. But the Shaykh and the Islamic organized religion defends them to death. And they are not even aware that they're committing shirk and kufr. Because to them they have legalized shirk and kufr. They just think that when you worship something besides Allah, or you say Jesus is the son of Allah, that's disbelief and that's shirk. But it's not, it's more than that. And I will explain why belief in Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj is actually a gateway to kufr and shirk. I will explain, also we'll discuss the meaning of the beginning of Surah Al-Isra, that's Surah number 17, and the ayah number 1, where Allah transported somebody from the sacred masjid to the farthest masjid to show him the biggest miracles. This ayah is used by Salafis, by Sheikhs, by everybody to prove that Al-Isra, which is the journey between Mecca to Jerusalem, did actually take place. You'll be surprised at how much lies are laid there. But anyhow, so why aren't the Isra and Al-Mi'raj, which they say happened in the same at the same time, why were they mentioned in two surahs, two different surahs, Surah Al-Isra 17, and the other surah is An-Najm, and with the years and years difference between the two events? So why didn't Allah mention them both in one surah to talk to us about them? We'll discuss that also about that. History further deepens the confusion about these two events, because there is a huge number of disagreements about Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj. I will mention a few of them. And then there is the atomic bomb. The biggest thing that you're going to hear is the origins of this blasphemous belief of Al-Isra al-Mi'raj. Where does it, do they originate from? And you'll be surprised that Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj exist in the Bible, the New and Old Testament. All what our sheikhs did is they removed people from the Bible and they put Muhammad in that. And I will mention the text from the Bibles, and you're gonna see the similarness. It's incredible how alike the texts are. And this is why Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj is more of a biblical tale than an Islamic one. And I will prove that in this talk. We will also learn about other people in the Bible who have ascended to heaven and they met with God. And I will tell you also what happened. More than 10 people have ascended to heaven. So the Isra and Al-Mi'raj idea aren't exclusive act to Prophet Muhammad. In fact, no, so many people happen. But anyhow, I'll tell you about this biblical text and how it became an Islamic hadith narrative. Also, I will mention some facts about the Aqsa Mosque in Palestine today. Those facts are kept hidden from you, because once you know them, you're gonna say, wow, is this what it is? And was it truly the first of the two Qiblas, as they say, and that it is the third shrine in Islam? You'll be surprised as around those big lies that have been formulated around this topic, i.e. the Aqsa Masjid. The Isra and Mi'raj post events, i.e. what happened after Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj, accuse Allah of aiding and helping his messenger to lie and deceive the people of Mecca. And this is very dangerous indeed. The messenger of Allah did not see Jerusalem at night. He just went to a spot, as they, of course, the hadith say, and then he went to heaven. But when he spoke to Mecca, the hadith in Bukhari and authentic narrations, they say that Allah displayed Jerusalem to the messenger and he was seeing it street by street, which means Allah was helping the messenger lie to Mecca, because people of Mecca will say, oh, it's true, he's been to Jerusalem and he's seen it, when in fact he didn't, and Allah was cheating with the messenger. Is this something about Allah? But again, our books say this, and the sheikhs believe in this, and they preach with this, but they don't link it with the accusation against Allah. Also, we're going to see the political footprints in this Isra and Al-Mi'raj, and how they have been politically taken care of, and how they were I will explain more about that. And then we will come, point number 31, to the conclusion in end of this incredible widespread lie. And also we will discuss if the Salat was given in Al-Isra or Al-Mi'raj. Of course it was not, it was before that. And the whole thing, my notes have reached the 50 pages, and I intend, inshallah, at the end of this talk, to gather all my notes about Al-Isra al-Mi'raj, and there'll be like 150 pages. It's going to be a complete book, and I will inshallah, edit it to make it a book, and then I will PDF it and put it on the internet as to why this Isra al-Mi'raj is one of the biggest lies, one of the biggest crooked charades that have been played on Muslims, and that Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj contradict the Quran, contradict everything that is honest and authentic in this Islam. So this is what you will expect, inshallah, in the upcoming talk. So please, I will start recording the talks either today, that is Thursday, the 21st of January, or tomorrow, Friday, and you should have them. I expect about 5 or 6 talks, but it is well worth. It's a knowledge that will help you come out of the confusion and the abuse and all that dark, shadowy, politically abused and undertaken Islam that you lived in for years. The more you know about your Islam, the more you link with the Quran, the freer you are and the happier you are. Again, this is your brother Abdusalam, and I will inshallah speak to you in the next installment. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.